In this video, we'll briefly discuss the early experiments used to discover the genetic material. Early geneticists didn't know what carried the genes. They had some information about what the substance had to be like. They knew some of the properties of the substance, but they didn't know its physical structure. They knew that it needed to contain information. Had to be easy to copy reliably. And it had to be variable between individuals to account for diversity. But even with that, they didn't know what the genetic material was, and they didn't know where specifically in the cell it was found. It wasn't until later researchers were observing the cell during cell division that they realized and recognized that the chromosomes were acting exactly as the genetic material should. And so, through their observations, they were able to determine that chromosomes carried genes. And so, they were led to the question, well, what are chromosomes made of? Through biochemical analysis, they were able to determine that chromosomes were made out of DNA and protein. And so, which of those two were the genetic material? The early scientists, they didn't really know. But looking at these two substances, proteins, they knew that they could be very large, They definitely seemed complex enough to store information because there were 20 different amino acids. Conversely, DNA, it seemed too simple. It seemed too streamlined. It was unlikely because there were only 4 different nucleotides. Really, once researchers heard that chromosomes were made out of both DNA and protein, they're like, oh, I knew that protein was going to be the genetic material. It just makes sense. And so, most of the scientific community was under that assumption that the genetic material had to be the protein. DNA was just too small and too unlikely. Well, there were a series of early experiments that are important to understand the journey or the voyage in which we took to find that DNA was in fact the genetic material. Now the first experiment that I'd like to share with you, the Griffith experiment, it wasn't there trying to ask whether DNA or protein was the genetic material. In fact, the Griffith experiment pretty much was done to prove that there was such a thing known as a transformative substance. And this we now recognize as the genetic material. Now the model that Frederick Griffith was using in this particular experiment was that he was looking at 2 different strains of a particular type of bacteria, a pneumococcus bacteria. Now these 2 strains, one was lethal to lab mice, and the other was not. And this information, it was known before Griffith's experiment. So let's look at what Griffith saw and did in his experiments. What Griffith saw was the transformation of one strain of bacteria by another. So our 2 strains of bacteria. We have the R strain, which is harmless to mice. And the S strain of this pneumococcus bacteria, which is deadly. Now the reason why these 2 strains of bacteria have these names is when you grow them on a petri dish, the colonies of the R strain, they look rough, they look textured. Whereas the S strain, they have this smooth, glistening, almost oil-like surface to them that is very, very smooth. So S stands for smooth, R stands for rough. But the rough ones are harmless, whereas the S strain are deadly to lab mice. Now, if Griffith took these deadly bacteria and he boiled them, he killed them with heat, well, these heat-killed S strain bacteria are harmless. just like the R strain on their own. Now the surprising thing is that Griffith took the harmless R strain bacteria. He took the heat-killed S strain bacteria, which also on its own was harmless. He combined the two and injected that into the mouse. And sure enough, the mouse died. Somehow this heat-killed S strain made the R strain deadly. So what's really going on here? Well, when Griffith did an autopsy on the mice, he found living S strain bacteria within the mouse. So again, what's going on here? Well, I will say it's not that we're dealing with zombie bacteria. Instead, somehow, the harmless R strain was transformed into the deadly S strain. And in that transformation process, now when that bacterial cell will divide, its offspring will also be that deadly S strain variety. That's what ended up leading to the death of that mouse. So again, to recap, the R strain on its own is harmless. S strain is deadly to the mouse. If we take that S strain and boil it and kill those cells and inject that into the mouse is fine. It's only when we combine the heat-killed S strain of bacteria and the living R strain of bacteria that now we have this lethal bacteria again. And the bacteria that were removed from the mouse during the autopsy, they were living S strain bacteria. So this was Griffith's experiment. Several years later, a group of researchers known as Avery, McLeod, and McCarty, or Oswald Avery, Colin McLeod, and Macklin McCarty, they performed an experiment in 1944 which used the same system as Griffith, using the R strain and the S strain bacteria and testing its lethality on mice. What they were able to do is that they showed by purifying different components from the heat-killed S-strain bacterial mixture and adding them to the living R-strain bacteria, one component at a time, only the DNA portion of the solution could transform the cells. This was really exciting. This showed that DNA somehow had the ability to transform the cells. Avery, McLeod, and McCarty were excited by their findings and shared them with the scientific community. And the scientific community pretty much just shut them down, told them, no, you must have made some mistake. We know it's protein that's the genetic material. So that DNA is transforming the bacteria. You must have done something wrong, or maybe that's just something weird with the bacteria. So another group of researchers, Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase, they performed an experiment which confirmed the findings of Avery, McLeod, and McCarty, but they used a very different system. Instead of R-strain and S-strain bacteria and looking at lethality in mice, they ended up using viruses as their model subjects. They took advantage of the fact that the element phosphorus is an integral part of DNA molecules, and that the element sulfur was an integral part of proteins, but not found in DNA. So what Hershey and Chase did is that they labeled the DNA in a bacteria virus with radioactive phosphorus, and they labeled the protein in another batch of bacteria virus with radioactive sulfur. Now luckily, this virus that they're working with is made out of only DNA and protein, so it could function as a great example of what the chromosomes probably were like as well. What Hershey and Chase found is that when they had radioactively labeled DNA in these viruses and allowed the viruses to infect the cells, it was the DNA that was transferred into the infected cells. Whereas if they had radioactively labeled protein and allowed the virus to infect the cells, the radioactivity remained external to the cells, out in the solution. And so this confirmed that DNA, not protein, is the genetic material. And the proof from Hershey and Chase's experiment was enough to finally convince the scientific community that they had been wrong about protein being the genetic material, and that it is, in fact, DNA. In our next video, we're going to talk about the discovery of the structure of DNA. See you then.